I'm gonna give you an award-winning lecture, and you're gonna learn stuff. So that's how this whole thing works, right? So let's talk about it. Okay, so let's talk about Unit 2. We talk about pharmacology. Why don't you guys tell me, because it's more fun when I hear your voice than my own voice on these videos. What are we going to learn? What are we going to learn in Unit 2? Pharmacology. Go ahead, Alex.
Probably about drugs.
About drugs? Let me think about that. Yeah, we are going to learn about drugs. What else? That was awesome. What else are we going to learn specifically about them, their drugs?
How they affect our brain,
how they affect
us.
How they affect our brain, how they affect us.
Yeah, what
yeah,
do they
that's
change?
True about everything.
What exactly do they change in the brain? What chemical?
What exactly do they change in the brain?
Process.
A little bit about that, yeah, for sure. We're going to do more detail in how drugs actually work structurally. Like, what is the kind of chemistry in front of us? A little more biochem than this is going to be on. Last unit was anatomy. This is a little bit more biochemistry. Do a biochemistry.
I'll take it.
I don't know.
So, the concepts. We're going to talk in how do drugs actually physically get into your body? So, how do drugs get in? Hey, Lauren. How drugs actually get around your body, the circulation of drugs. So, how do they get to the parts that matter? Drugs don't really matter until the drugs we're talking about don't really matter until they get to you. What organ?
Brain.
The brain. They don't really matter until they get to the brain. You can have all kinds of drugs in your body, but if they don't get to the brain, you're not going to see that kind of effect. Now, that's not true for all drugs, but for these specific drugs, because these are psychoactive drugs. They act on the brain.
Wait, is there any drug that, like, say, goes to your heart, or just, like,
yeah.
your pancreas, yeah. something, then it does something where it changes, and then if something sends something different to your brain?
Maybe, but there are many drugs that act on many different things. And there's specifically drugs that act just on our heart. Nitroglycerin causes less in, like, heart pain and stuff. So yes, there are drugs that affect different parts of the body. The elimination of drugs. Once the drugs are in the body and they circulate it, how do they get out? So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about eliminating drugs. So how do drugs get in? How do they move around? And how do they eliminate? Every drug acts differently and every drug is eliminated differently, which means the effects are different. You see the effects of cannabis are affected differently than the effects of PCP because of the biochemistry of that molecule and how your body works. The metabolism of drugs. How are drugs metabolized? So what is happening when a drug is being used by your body? Does that make sense? Metabolism? How does your body interact with that drug? What does it do? And the dosage. That matters. How do we determine dosage, and what does that mean? Because we take drugs differently. What's the difference between chewing tobacco and smoking tobacco? What's the difference between smoking crack and snorting cocaine? Or, you know, snorting heroin versus injecting heroin? Those are all different things. And what other factors influence how we respond to drugs? These are all things that we're going to be focusing on when we talk about pharmacology. It's all of that stuff. So it is about drugs and how they affect your body, but it's very specifically what are the factors that determine why a drug acts a certain way. Why is drug A stronger than drug B?
Define stronger.
That's the influence. And the last little bit. Why is mixing drugs an issue?
Yeah, that's interesting.
I like to mix an upper and a downer and see which one wins. So I'll take depressants and antidepressants and see who wins the battle in my body. No, I don't do that. We'll talk about mixing drugs. So, what is a molecule? We already talked about this. You know this. Something. What is a molecule? That she loves that icon for brainstorm. What is a molecule?
Brainstorm.
A combination of like a cluster.
A cluster of atoms that forms using covalent bonds is what you said, Ashley?
Yeah.
That's not bad. A group of atoms that forms a covalent bond. That's fantastic. By the way, this PowerPoint's already on Edmodo. You're welcome. So what is a molecule? The group of organisms, a group of atoms held together by covalent bonds. Want I should write that down? I will. of atoms held together by covalent bonds. Example would be like H2O, which is
carbon dioxide. Water.
H2O, which is oxygen bonded to two hydrogens.
H2O, sorry.
Or
C6H12. I don't know. I'm stupid.
C6H12O6, which is which looks more like this.
What is that? C6H12O6.
Something like that is not perfect. There's big issues with that, but that's pretty close to what it is.
What C6H is held together by covalent bonds.
Yeah. Group of atoms held together by covalent bonds. They're clustered together. Sugar is always going to be, glucose is always going to be C6H12O6. It's always going to be that ratio. You're always going to have 6 carbon, 12 hydrogen, and 6 water, or oxygen, or 6 carbon and 12 water.
Oh, which group?
Yeah. So that's a group of atoms held together by covalent bonds.
Okay.
I'm waiting. It's being a little bit.
Better friggin' not be, is all I gotta say. It's not frozen, it's just waiting. Watch, it's gonna go really fast. Take a second. I don't know why.
But if your computer's a piece of garbage. It's not that it's Gateway makes a piece of garbage, it's just like seven. I donated this to school, my old computer.
Is it the computer
or is it the internet? There we go. Oh man, that's so embarrassing. It was recording the whole time.
All right. So here we go. I'll try and edit out that a little bit. So biomolecules. So molecules for life. Biomolecules for life. The ones that matter. Biomolecules. What are some of the biomolecules that we will be discussing?
Water.
Water. Yeah, sure. Water. Definitely. That's important for life. Absolutely important for life. All the chemical reactions that we're going to be talking about happen in water. The reason we have so much water is so that we can do chemical reactions. So yes, water is definitely. What's another molecule that we'll be talking about then acts on biological systems?
Methane?
Just doing a class, a group of biological molecules. How about drugs? Will drugs be something we'll be talking about? Yes, absolutely, Mr. Brewer. Thanks for asking. Thanks for telling. Drugs would be a biomolecule. These are biologically active molecules. Now, there is a class of 4 groups of biological molecules that we need to talk about. You've already talked about them in some detail. You'll recognize the names. There are 4 groups of molecules that you're made of. You're basically a collection of these 4 types of molecules. Do you know what they are? They're called the big 4 macromolecules. Amino acids plays into it, but it isn't.
Proteins.
We've got
enzymes.
What's that molecule?
DNA,
it's known as a nucleic acid. Nucleic acid. Alright, that's what the NA stands for. So the nucleic acids like RNA, DNA, and ATP is a nucleic acid. ATP, which means for energy. So nucleic acids is one type. There's another type there. What type is that?
Carbohydrates.
Grains. There you go. No, carbohydrates. Carbohydrates, which you use for energy and a little bit for structure. Carbohydrates. You take a little water, add it to carbon, you make a carbohydrate. That's why it's called a carbohydrate. And we use it for energy storage, sugar, and structure.
Okay.
What's that one? Yeah, say it loud and proud, Josh Decker.
Lipids.
Or fat. What do we use lipids for?
Cell membranes.
Cell membranes and? What else do we use lipids for?
Energy, right?
Energy, long-term energy storage, and for protection and support. We have fat deposits to help us keep us insulated and supported and protected.
I love potato chips.
What?
I love potato chips.
Thank you, Joe, for that observation. I love potato chips.
I love them. They're great.
And the very last one.
They're great.
Yeah, that
protein.
Protein. So this one's kind of a big deal. Protein's a big deal. It's a big deal, and it has a lot of different jobs. If we went to nucleic acid, two jobs. Data storage, energy retrieval. That's what
is energy retrieval?
Energy ATP. It's purely with a rubber hits the road, energy usage, that's ATP, that's nucleic acid. Talk about carbohydrates. It's mostly energy storage. It has a few other jobs, but it's mostly storing energy for later. Lipids has a couple of jobs, mostly energy storage and protection. Proteins have a large amount of jobs. Again, they can store energy. All four of these, you can store energy in these molecules. But what else do proteins do? Transport. We have transport proteins. We have these gates and we have these pumps. So transporting is something, yes?
Enzymes
fall into that also. So with these proteins, you've got, they're pretty important. You've got enzymes, transporters, and receptors. Receptor is the way that cells identify chemicals. It does no good to have a chemical in your body if your body can't recognize it and respond. Drugs only work if you have a receptor for them. So if you're deficient in a receptor, that drug will not have effect on you. If it's a receptor type of interaction. Does that make sense? Can you follow me, Claire? I don't know everything I need to know. Except for now when you talk about drawing molecules. So how do we diagram them? These are two diagrams of two different molecules. Here's THC, which some of you may have heard, and acetaminophen, which again, you may have heard. The two different drugs that interact in the body, that's what they look like. Can you interpret those diagrams? Do you understand them at all?
Kind of do like the NH and OH group.
NH, OH, looks like you've got some C's and some other things, yeah? You got a HO, I see a HO. This and this are the same. So this HO and that H, this HO over here on the acetaminophen and the HO on the THC, those are so, some drug molecules, you know about those. Okay, so this is something that a former student of mine, I won't say his name, but his nickname is Cody Landers, got really annoyed with this idea that we would assume carbon and not draw in the hydrogens that we need to draw in. So he got pretty upset with this, and so I don't know if I can communicate this in a way that won't get you upset, but carbon, in biomolecules, when we draw them, we don't draw the carbons if we don't have to. We just don't draw them because it's annoying and there's lots of carbon in these molecules, so we don't draw them, we just assume them. So anywhere where you see an intersection,
I'm going to freeze this up again.
Anywhere that you see an intersection, so if you see right here, or end of chains, or right here, those are carbons. Carbon forms four bonds, and so it's going to be the skeleton structure of these molecules. This is a carbon, this is a carbon, that's a, you know, here's a carbon here, here's a carbon here, here's a carbon here. All of these intersections and ends of chains are carbons. Now these carbons happen to be drawn out. They don't, this and this are actually identical things. They didn't have to actually draw that out. They did, but they didn't have to. So they did. Carbons are assumed. So anywhere there's a mark, there's a carbon. So if I was counting carbons, on acetaminophen, it's a different color, counting carbons. Though it seems a little bit sacrilegious not to use black for carbon. If I was counting carbons, I would say there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There are 8 carbons on this one. So 8 carbons. On this one, I would count 1, 2, 3, 4, there's actually 4 of those, So that's actually 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20. Oh, 21. 21 carbons. I believe I counted that correctly. Yeah, 21 carbons. Much more complex. THC is a much more complex molecule than acetaminophen. It's got more carbon, more structure, more. The shape is more complex. So carbons are assumed. Any of the lines are bonds. They're just joins. They're joining bonds between molecules. And of course, molecules have bonds. That's what holds them together. And nitrogen, O is oxygen, H is hydrogen. The hydrogens are only drawn if they're important for the structure of the molecule. If they're not important, they're just assumed. They're just assumed because, again, drawing the H's is annoying. So anywhere that a carbon does not have four bonds, the rest of the bonds are filled in with hydrogen. So an example, color. Let's use green. An example would be this point right. Make this all dirty. This point right here that has 1, 2, 3 lines on that carbon. Carbon makes four bonds, so that would have one hydrogen attached to it. So right here, this carbon has 1, 2, 3, 4 bonds, so there's no hydrogen attached to it. How we doing? Is that like, whoa, Mr. Brewer, you're really smart, and attractive, and awesome, and really good at, like, baseball and stuff.
Yeah, I know. Heard you want to be the assistant coach for basketball.
Yeah, I'm going to be the assistant coach for
really?
Basketball. No.
Right.
I will do a three-point contest with anybody on the team, though.
Wait, what?
I'll do a three-point contest with anybody on the team.
That's cool.
But I guess you're close.
That's cool.
So not a three-point contest.
Well, it's fine. I don't want to play your stupid game. All right, so some important groups, some important groups that matter. CH3. And I bet you can see some CH3s. I can see 1, 2, 3 CH3 groups.
4 CH3.
I see 3. I know which one you're looking at. Are you looking at this guy over here?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's part of a longer chain, so it's not by itself. It has to be by itself.
Oh.
That's called a methyl group. Methyl group, that matters. Write that one down. Say methyl group, brain. Remember methyl group for later. COCH3, a COCH3 group. I don't see any COCH3 groups. Oh, wait. Oh, you're right. There is 4 methyl groups. 1, 2, 3, 4 methyl groups. My bad. Good job, Ronald. COCH3, I'm not seeing any. That's called an acetyl group. You may have heard of acetylene or acetylcholine or
acetaminophen.
Acetaminophen doesn't have an acetyl group in it. Yeah, it does.
Oh,
right here.
That hurts.
COCH3. There's the acetyl group right there. COCH3.
Really?
Yeah, that's the acetyl group. Acetaminophen is what I'm talking about there. And NH2 or NH3, that's an amine group. So you see an amine group here. I've made a mess of this diagram. You see an amine group there. So those are called functional groups. They confer function on the molecule. Those are important. So amine groups, methyl groups, and acetyl groups are the big ones. We're going to talk a lot about methylization or methylation. How many methyl groups a molecule has. For example, the difference between caffeine and chocolate. We already talked about that in previewing this unit. The difference between caffeine and chocolate is caffeine has 3 methyl groups, which is why it's called trimethylxanthine. And theobromine, which is active molecule in chocolate, has 2 methyl groups. The difference between methylbromine and caffeine is that one extra methyl group makes it act more powerful.
So is it dimethylbromine?
No.
But isn't that 2?
Yeah, I know, but it's got with the name. One more tiny little thing, and then I'll be finished with you. What molecules can drugs influence? What molecules can? How can they influence each other? So we've got this lock and key model. That's that ligand receptor kind of model. So you got this molecule that can attach. It has to be able to attach to the receptor to be able to be influenced or to influence on whatever it is. It has to attach to that receptor. So For THC to work in your brain, there must be receptors responsive to THC, the chemical. There are many chemicals that we interact with that do not have an effect on us because we don't have those receptors. We happen to have receptors for cannabinoids and other things.
So what if it's a partial agonist?
Yeah, so it's partial. That has to do with the fidelity of fit. So we have agonists or antagonists. If it fits, it can block. It can be a blocker or an inducer. So if it fits in that lock and key model, so that molecule fits, it can either cause the response or impede the response, retard the response, slow it down. So you've got the agonist, which allows it to happen. Oh, look at that. And you've got the antagonist, which stops it, closed for business.
So opening.
That's actually what it looks like in itself.
Yeah, this isn't a diagram. This is literally a picture of what's going on inside itself.
Liar.
Yeah, this is a documentary. Events are happening in real time. Let's see what we got here. I haven't actually gone before. Oh, yeah. So there are some other interactions. You can do the receptor key and lock, or you can have enzymes come along. Enzymes can actually destroy molecules. Enzymes can actually destroy them. You have enzymes that can break things down, or they can stop things from being broken down. So that's another, and so that would increase the response. So an example of that would be aspirin. Aspirin is an enzyme. It works on enzymes. So it works on enzymes. Oxycodone works on a lock and a key model. It acts like the opiates in your brain, your natural opiates. Aspirin acts a different way. Aspirin acts by blocking enzymes that break down certain things.
Oh.
Yeah.